Good morning. Welcome to Anchor Church. I'm glad that you're here with us, whether you're in the room or on the other side of that camera somewhere. We love you. We're glad that you're part of us. The Lord has a message for us today coming out of John chapter 15. If you look at John chapter 15, I promise, I say this from time to time, I have not gone soft on you, but we're going to look at one verse. What? You're not going to read half of a chapter this morning, Pastor? No, I'm not. Now, you know me well enough to know I'm going to read some other scripture. It's not going to be this one, just this one verse. But this one verse is the message this morning, and we're just going to support it with some other places. John 15, verse 11 is the scripture we're going to key off of today. And the title of the message is this. And before I even say it, I'm going to learn a lot about you, those of you that are in this room that I can see, just by telling you the name of the sermon. Some of you are laughing at me already. I'm going to learn a lot about some of you just by telling you what to call your notes. This message is titled, "You're Full of Something." You're all full of something. Some of you, I can tell where it is by where your brain went just now. I told you. You're full of something is this morning's message. Let's read this passage, let's pray, and let's hear what the Lord has to say to us. John 15:11 says this. Jesus is speaking, and he says, "I have spoken these things to you so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be full." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you this morning for your word. I thank you that it is easy to read. I thank you that it is accessible to us, and I thank you that we live in a place where we can gather to share it with one another. I'm grateful that you have kept it alive and active and that we can still apply it to our lives today. I thank you, Father, that this still means something to us and that you're still working in the earth today and you're still speaking to us through these words as we read them. I pray today that we would apply them well, that we would hear them well. I pray that your spirit would be active in the lives of those who are listening, and it would be active right now as we're actively listening to your word, that you would remove any filters that would cause us to hear something different than what you would say. And Father, I pray that your spirit would work in us so that we hear and receive what you have for us to hear and receive this morning. I pray that I will speak well and speak clearly so that that can happen, and that if I make any mistakes that mine are erased and that your purpose is still accomplished in our time of sharing your word this morning. Speak to us today and equip us to do your work as we leave. In your name, amen. You're full of something. Jesus says, "I've spoken some things to you so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be full." You're full of something. If you weren't, you wouldn't be here. If you didn't have something sustaining you, keeping you going, driving you, keeping you focused, causing you to behave the way that you do, you wouldn't be here. We sang a song this morning that says, "It's your breath in our lungs. I'm full of air that God gave me." Let's empty the air out of you and see how long you hang around with us. Doesn't work that way. Let's take the blood that's in your body and drain it out. Doesn't work that way. Let's take the clarity of your mind and remove it. Let's wipe it clean, and suddenly your body can't function anymore. Something changes. You're full of something. And there's something more than just the biological component of my body working that makes me full. There's that thing you hear people talk about, the weight of the soul. You know, when people die, they lose this minuscule amount of weight in their body. They call that the weight of the soul. Whether you buy into that idea or not, we know there's something in us that's more than just this. I mean, the Lord reached down and formed us out of the dirt, and we weren't alive until he breathed his breath into us. Something fills us that sustains us and keeps us alive until the day that we die. Jesus is giving an instruction on the fact that we need to be full of something very specific in order to be able to serve him and to be content in our service to him. Some people have an idea, and there are some who have even said to me, because I sometimes do preach about more difficult things, and I'm very practical. And I've said many times, you're not guaranteed anything other than your salvation when you come into a relationship with the Lord. And that means that sometimes things are going to be hard. And I've preached a lot over the last year about things being hard, because my life has been hard. And the Lord has spoken to me a lot about how to serve him and praise him during difficult times. And I'm still not very good at it a lot of the time.
I speak a lot about hard times, but the Lord says I need you to be full of something. And it's not just that you would be full so that you can get through hard times. There's got to be something full so that I can actually enjoy my service to him, whether it's difficult or whether it's great, whether my life is going well or it's going poorly. The Lord says, I need you full of something. And here's what it is. I have spoken these things to you so that my joy may be in you. And the joy that you have will fill you up. That idea of being full, when Jesus says it here, it means complete and furnished. If you play video games, it's like you're leveled all the way up. I can't get any bigger and stronger. I'm equipped with everything I can possibly collect. Jesus uses that word full 20 times in the course of his ministry. And when he uses it, Hebrew is an interesting language because it's not just a word with a definition where you look it up and it says this word means this thing. Hebrew is a language that comes with entire concepts attached to a word. So this idea of being full does not just mean I'm complete, because we know without Christ I'm incomplete, and we know we're getting sanctified constantly and we're becoming more holy and becoming more like him the more time we spend in his presence. So I'm not complete just the minute that I become saved. So full has to mean something more than that. It's describing a process of being filled. In fact, the cultural context means you are full and you are expecting overflow. I'm not just getting leveled up to the top. Full, when Jesus says it here, is I'm going to pour something into you, and my joy, you should expect it to flow over the edges and be more than you can handle. The baseline, entry level, is more than you can take. If anything else was added to the kind of fullness that he's instructing us to have, it wouldn't fit inside the container. It would spill out. And that phrase, joy may be full, is specific to the writing of John. You're getting a little bit of a history lesson this morning with this message. We talk about the synoptic gospels sometimes, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They're basically the same. John is unique because it's a personal account about the deity of Jesus, the God-like nature of Jesus, the fact that he is the Son of God. And John, we know from studying him a couple of years ago, we spent literally seven and a half months studying the person of John and all of his writing. And John was the only disciple who knew Jesus from the time he was in his teens and then served him for a full life until he died of old age. He had a personal experience with Jesus in his formative years. And so the things that he recorded about Jesus were different than what the other men did. They gave more like a history lesson of what happened on Jesus. And John gave us a lesson of what it was like to know him. And so there are things Jesus said that were important to John that stood out, that got recorded nowhere else. And this is one of those things. In fact, that phrase of your joy being made full, it's specific in John's writing. And John records Jesus saying it six different times. That should be a number that's familiar to you, because you know I like numbers as well as words. Six is man's number when we talk about the numerical significance of things in this culture that Jesus was living in. It's man's number. And that phrase that your joy should be full happens six times. It's connected to humanity. It's the idea of us being incomplete and Jesus saying this is how you make up for that. My joy will make you full, overflow, no longer incomplete, but have more than you can handle. And the very interesting thing to me, even beyond six times, six is man's number, this is an idea of completeness. All six times that it's spoken, it gets spoken to imperfect, broken people who are obviously in distress. The fullness of joy that Jesus has for us, he specifically spoke it to people who had anxiety, who were stressed out, who were depressed, who were in difficult life situations, who were actively being persecuted for what they believed, people who were hungry and tired and didn't have enough and didn't know how they were going to get by. He spoke that phrase to people who were lonely and thought they had no one on their side and no one supported them and everyone had abandoned them. All that I love is dead or has left me. He spoke it to people who were in the midst of doing their best and yet still felt like they were failing miserably to walk out their faith. fullness of joy. Jesus impressed the importance of that not on people that had it all together and had everything and wanted the whole world to know, look how great we are and how great our God is because of how awesome it is. Look at my new car and my nice house and all my bills being paid and all the money I can just scatter around to solve all my problems. He didn't once use this phrase with those people. He says, I want to make full those of you who are broken and incomplete and stressed out and are doing your best but feel like you come up short. Jesus says, I'm telling you about these things so that what I have will be in you and you'll overflow with it. Jesus had an understanding, and John saw the value of recording Jesus's understanding that people long to be filled with something. I'm looking for something to fill me up. People, by nature, we feel somewhat empty. We're looking for something. I got to find a place I fit. I've got to find a spouse. I'm hungry. I need some food. I recognize my incompleteness in my everyday life over and over and over again. If everything in humanity, if all of creation was meant to draw our attention back to the Lord, then does it not make sense that the fact that we're aware of our incompleteness means that was built in so that we would begin looking for him and we would begin trying to find him? If everything is supposed to point toward him, then we were designed as incomplete so that we would seek something to fill us and ultimately would find the only one that could. And that may mean we go through a process of finding some other things that leave us feeling lacking. You've certainly filled yourself up with some other stuff. Sports fans, you probably know all the stats from all of your favorite players and every game that got played this week. I'm not a sports fan. I don't know those things. Some of you probably do. Now, I know a bunch of music theory. I could walk you through the signal chain on my pedal board. In fact, I did that recently in a video. All kinds of technical stats that would sound foreign to people that don't know it, but I filled myself with some of that information. And I know what the relative minor of the key of G is, and most of you wouldn't care. But the musicians do, because we filled ourselves with that. You might have filled yourself with a bunch of useless facts. I got a favorite one because I like useless facts. Did you know that if you took all of the gold in the entire world and you gathered it together in one place at the same time, all of the known gold, it would cover a football field about 3 inches thick? That's all the gold there is in the world. Don't you feel enriched and more equipped to go out and do the work of the Lord because you know that? Of course you don't. It's useless information. But we fill ourselves with something, and somehow that got stuck in my brain. Dad jokes. You know a couple of these? I could share a few. I won't go there this morning. We'd be here too long, and no one would stay or be interested. Movie quotes. Secrets that people have told you. Solutions to problems. Some of them that you got to implement, and some of them that you just wish somebody would, but they didn't ask me. We've got dreams. We've got hopes. We've got bad habits. We've got likes and dislikes. Maybe we got a couple of Bible verses and prayers crammed in there. Maybe. You're seeking something to fill you up, and you're full of something. And Jesus is talking about the significance of being full. And he says, you will only be full and completed by his joy. Not by happiness. Notice he didn't say that my happiness would be in you. Notice he didn't say that my entertainment would fill you up. He didn't say that doing fun things would fill you up. He said joy, specifically. He didn't say that what you know will fill you up, and he didn't say that your feelings will do you well. He said, my joy will be full in you. That's something that's interesting about joy. We know joy and happiness aren't the same thing. I don't need to reteach that. We've talked about it many, many times. But something that's interesting about joy is that it's something that you can have and be full of in any situation, but you can't make it. I can do some things that will make me happy for a minute, but I cannot make myself be joyful. I have to receive that from somewhere else, because joy is something that comes from outside of me. God breathed his breath into me and placed his spirit inside of mankind. And the fruit of the spirit is love, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, joy, gentleness. You know the list. We're going to read it in a minute. I'm getting ahead of myself. But joy is not a feeling. Joy is something that comes out of my spirit, and if it's the right kind of joy, it comes from the Lord. That's the kind that lasts forever, and I can't make that. It has to come from him and from his spirit. Joy is a condition of my spirit. It's part of the eternal piece of me that stays in me when my body is long gone. It's talked about a couple of other places in Scripture. If you look at Psalm 16, verses 8 through 11, we see David. He was a king and also a poet. He gets so much credit for being a king, but he's a songwriter and a poet as well. He's a creative man. And he writes, I always remember that God is with me. He is here, close by my side, so nothing can defeat me, so that my heart and my soul will be full of joy. I will live in safety because my God will not abandon me to hell. He will teach me how to live well. In your presence, Lord, there is abundant joy. Your hand is a pleasant place for all of eternity. Now, I like this because David is speaking about joy, and that's in the Old Testament. That's in the life of someone who's never laid eyes on and never will lay eyes on Jesus, not in his human form on the earth. David is writing about the hope of a joy that John actually got to experience and live in. Being spiritually full of something that has eternal value, John got to live that because it says Jesus looked at the disciples and breathed into them. And then he was there when the upper room happens and the Spirit of Pentecost comes and the Spirit of God falls on people and fills them. And for the first time, the same Spirit that lived in Jesus now lives in us. But it's been around forever. David wrote about it. I have to be full of something, and it's going to have to come from the Lord. Paul expands on that idea. Philippians 4, 6, and 7 says, don't worry about anything, but in everything through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus. Now he's talking about peace. It's another one of those things. It's a condition of my spirit that comes from the Lord that I can't make. I can't create it. I have to seek the Lord for it. If you're missing joy and peace, in fact, we're going to read that list here in just a moment. I'm getting to it. If you're missing those things in your life, you're not going to create them with your job or with your relationships or with anything that you do for yourself or taking that mental health day and going and doing the thing you like to do. You're going to create it by getting in the presence of God and saying, God, fill me with what I can't make. Fill me with what I can't create myself. Breathe into me the peace that I'm missing because I feel like my life is in pieces. I have a friend of mine, he says, my life's in shambles. I love that word because that makes it sound really bad. Shambles. I need joy because I'm not happy. I'm depressed all the time. And I know that the joy of the Lord in my spirit may not change whatever chemical issue I have in my brain. It may not make me happy all the time, but I can find joy. But I've got to have it from the Lord. Lord, I need it from you. If you're missing those things, you've got to invest the time in the kingdom of God. And I don't mean go out and do good works. I mean get alone on your face before God and say, between just you and me, Lord, this is what I need and I don't have it. Pour it into me. Don't show me how I can make it because I know I can't make it. Don't show me where I can go purchase it. Don't give me some exchange program because I know that's not how it works. God, I just, out of your grace and your mercy, I need you to invest these things in me. You have not because you ask not. And when you ask amiss. We have to ask for the right things in the right place. I'm not going to find these things that the Spirit creates somewhere else. God is the source of peace and of joy. Peace that I can't comprehend without him. Joy that doesn't make sense in the midst of my broken circumstances. His peace and joy come when finding peace and joy in the situation defy all logic. I'm bankrupt, but I still have peace and joy. My children are running amok and they don't want anything to do with the Lord, but I still have peace and joy. I hate my job. My marriage is a wreck. I don't know how I'm going to pay the light bill, but I still have peace and joy. Incomprehensible, beyond all understanding. That's what the Lord wants to dispense. That requires something more than just your natural confidence and your human will. This is where we get into that verse, Galatians 5, 22 and 23. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, self-control, and against those things there is no law. The things that we seek to be satisfied in both our everyday life and our service to God Almighty only come from him. The idea that I'm going to get myself in order and then do something great for God is nonsense. The idea that I'm going to get myself in order and I'm going to work through my problems and then I'm going to go to God is completely backwards because nothing that is going wrong in your life can get fixed by any effort of yours apart from asking the Lord to satisfy it. all of these things come from being in the presence of God and nowhere else. Because apart from him, there is no peace in you. There is no joy in you. There is no kindness or goodness or gentleness. If you don't believe that, spend 10 minutes in rush hour traffic and then show me the kindness and goodness that's in every one of you, right? I don't have any. I become proficient in sign language and sailor when I get stuck in traffic. And then I have to repent because I don't have kindness and gentleness in me by nature. There's not very many of us in the room, and those of you online are just going to have to bear with me. I may lose you on this one. There are times when I look at the issues in my own life, and when someone comes up and asks me to pray for Aunt Sally's stubbed toe or their bad cold or the fact that they're just having such a hard day they don't think they can get out of bed, I find out real quick I don't have a whole lot of goodness in me. Because I want to start taking your problem and compare it to my problem and go, you want to know what real problems are? I'm sure none of you have ever experienced that. You're very kind and patient with everybody that wants to come tell you their problems, because you probably don't have any real problems because you're probably better Christians than me. Pray for your pastor. I find out real quick that without the Lord in my life, I don't have those things. I can't do what he's asked and called me to do without his Spirit, and neither can you. Whether that's preach or teach or work in a factory or drive a bus or stay home and take care of your kids or cook for your spouse, there's not a single thing the Lord's ordained for you to do that you're capable of doing with the right attitude unless his attitude is what's in you. Apart from God, we don't have those things. And there's no capacity for it in us because we can't produce it. The Spirit of God makes it, and the Spirit of God makes room for it. John goes on and he talks even more about this in his gospel. If you look at chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, Jesus is speaking and he says, I will give you a comforter to be with you forever. I'll come back to this. That's because we need him all the time. We don't need the Holy Spirit to flop around like a fish and babble up here in front of the altar and pray louder than everybody else and speak nonsense and fall on the floor and dance and cut cartwheels and jump over pews. Spirit expresses himself in a lot of ways through a lot of people. But if all it does is make you do that when you're in church, it's not the Spirit of God, and it's absolutely useless, because this says he's with me forever. That should be carried with me outside the building and do something useful and worthwhile for the kingdom of God, for the people that lack him outside the doors of my church. That's for free. It's not even in the notes. God will give you a comforter to be with you forever because you need him all the time. He's the Spirit of truth. The world is unable to receive him because it doesn't see him or know him, but you do, because he remains with you and will be in you. The Comforter, that's who brings you peace, joy, and direction. The Holy Spirit is who brings you those things. And it says in the next verse that the world doesn't see him because it doesn't know him, because the world is full of something else. The world can't see him because it's too full of what it produces. It's not the same thing as what the Spirit produces. It's not that they can't see him because he's invisible. They can't see him because they're not looking for him and they're full of something else. I feel satisfied by the things that I'm doing, by my good work, or even my wicked work. I enjoy this. Do you suffer from insanity? No, people around me do, but I enjoy it just fine. Sometimes we're full of things that we don't even realize we shouldn't enjoy. The world is full of something else. And remember that word fullness, it means about to overflow. The world is full to capacity and overflowing with things that are not the Spirit of God. So let me ask you, why would you go to the world to find satisfaction of something that only God can produce when you know what they're producing is the exact opposite? Why would we try to go fill ourselves with something out there that we weren't designed to be filled with and that is producing results that we don't want? Let's talk about what the world's full of for a minute. Got several verses for this. Psalm chapter 10, verses 3 through 11. David is writing again about wicked people. He says, the wicked one boasts about his own cravings. We can camp out there for a minute. This is what I like, and the rest of you have to deal with it, because it's who I am. It's how I'm made. This feels good to me. Don't tell me I can't. Matter of fact, we need to let everybody know that this can feel good so they have the opportunity to try it. Doesn't matter if they're kindergartners or 75 years old. They all need to know the opportunity to feel this good is there. Because I am obsessed with my cravings. I'm identified by them. It's who I am. It's what I want and it's what I like. So it's me. It's a problem. What's the world full of? The wicked ones boast about their cravings. The ones who are greedy curse and despise the Lord. In all of their scheming, the wicked arrogantly think there is no accountability and God does not exist. His ways are always secure. Your lofty judgments are beyond his sight. He scoffs at all of his adversaries. He says to himself, I'll never be moved from generation to generation without calamity. Cursing, deceit, and violence fill his mouth. Trouble and malice are under his tongue. He waits in ambush near the villages. He kills the innocent in secret places. His eyes are on the lookout for the helpless. He lurks like a lion in a thicket in secret. He lurks in order to seize the afflicted, and he seizes them and drags them off in a net. He is oppressed and beaten down. The helpless fall because of his strength, and he says to himself, God is forgotten. He hides his face, and he will never see. Look at that list of what the world produces and is full of. Cursing, deceit, violence, boasting about cravings, seeking entertainment and pleasuring themselves. The world is full of how can I make me feel good? And if I can't make me feel good, it's your fault. And something needs to be done about that. We need to take these people out. They have no place because they're keeping me from satisfying me. Paul talked about that same thing. Matter of fact, we just read about the fruit of the Spirit. If you just back up to the verses just before it, Galatians 5, 19 and 21, it says, the works of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, moral impurity, promiscuity, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambitions, dissension, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and anything similar. I'm telling you about these in advance, as I told you before. Those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Why? Because they're full of something other than God. They're full of something other than what God intended. What a horrific list. We say, who gets to decide what's good and what's bad? Well, there's a pretty comprehensive list of what wickedness looks like compared to God in this picture. One more time, if I can just reiterate, Ecclesiastes 9:3, there's another verse here. The hearts of people. Oh, now, wait a minute. This is not just saying wickedness. This is not just saying the hearts of the wicked are full. This is the hearts of people as a whole, humanity, apart from being filled with God. The hearts of people are full of evil and madness as long as they live, and after that, they go to the dead or they end up in hell. Without being filled by the Spirit of God, I am by default filled with these other things that we just spent the last few minutes saying are horrible and I want no part of. But that's my default setting. If you put me back to factory settings, that's what comes out. Since Genesis chapter 3, that's where we are. John, in his gospel, records Jesus saying, but you know the Comforter, and he should remain in you. We have to have a transplant of our spirit so that what's defaulting in me is removed and the Spirit of God is full, so there's no room for any of that other stuff anymore. It's important that we recognize that we long to be full of something. And when we know this, we've got to be conscious of what we're filling ourselves with because we're full of something. And sadly, we have so much access to entertainment. I mean, I've got a tablet right here. My laptop is over there. My phone is over there. I've got a huge television in my living room. There's a whole wide world outside. I can walk out and see what I want to see, or I can use any one of these devices from any place that I am because the internet just floats in the air now. And I can have access to anything that will satisfy me. Whatever craving I've got is on demand to be satisfied. We're full of something, and we will let things into our minds and into our hearts and into our households through one of those screens that we would not let through the front door if it came knocking at our house. The kind of wickedness the kind of witchcraft, the kind of violence, the kind of cursing and anger, the kind of cravings and lifestyles. We'll say, oh, that's just the way television is. That's just how people are. That's just the world we live in, and that's what I have to put up with in order to be able to enjoy things and turn my brain off for a minute. If they came to the front door and said, I want to do this on your sofa, I want to do this to your mom, to your brother, to your wife, would you let what you're putting in yourself through that thin piece of glass or plastic into your house if it were on the front stoop? Probably not. You're full of something. What are you filling yourself with? I'm not just talking about what media you consume, and this is not a message about listening to the right music and watching the right movies. We've had that beaten into our head forever. I'm talking about the condition of your spirit. Are you feeding yourself the things that the wicked would feed themselves? Or are you seeking to be overflowing with the joy and the peace and the goodness and the gentleness of God? Is what you're watching, what you're indulging in, what you're entertaining in your spirit fostering those things, or is it displacing them until you're full of something else? We started this morning talking about Jesus telling us the importance of being filled with the Holy Spirit, that your joy can be full, that we should expect an overflow of what He can offer if we'll seek it. And that overflow is guaranteed rather than being in a deficit, because we can go look at what the world has and we can fill ourselves with it over and over again, but it goes away. The tingly feeling lasts for a couple of minutes. The fullness lasts for a couple of minutes. The happiness eventually is going to go away because the event or the sensation will be over. The comforter stays with you forever and will fill you and keep you overflowing to the point that you're satisfied and there's no room for that other stuff. In a spirit-filled person, there is no room for anything other than what the Lord offers them. And when the Lord pours His Spirit into us, it displaces everything else. If we'll fill ourselves with the Spirit of God, the hunger and the emptiness and the longing and the brokenness that result from what we've put in ourselves eventually goes away. And here's an interesting thing. Sometimes when we say, I'm going to make a change, we just got to cross that date line of the new year, and we have resolutions that most of us have already ruined. I don't even bother making them. We draw a line and we say, okay, no more. And we would like to say, okay, today I'm going to draw a line and I'm going to receive what the Lord has for me and I'm going to ask His Spirit to fill me. And an interesting thing will happen. You will suddenly become aware of all the garbage that's in your life when that happens. You know why? I wish I'd brought an object lesson with me. You put a bunch of ping pong balls in a pitcher and you fill it with water. And if that water is the Spirit of God and the ping pong balls are the garbage that I put in there, what happens? They float. And they eventually come to the top and they have to run out and spill over. And we will come to the Lord and say, Lord, fill me with Your Spirit. And then in that moment, or in the next day, or the next couple of weeks, the garbage that's in there begins to float to the top, and that becomes the most visible thing. And then we say, I failed, this is not worth it, I can't go on, there's no point. When the truth is, this is actually the progress of God working in your life, because it's pushing those things out. This morning, I want to encourage you to begin filling yourself with the Spirit of God. This morning, I want to give you an opportunity to fill yourself with the Spirit of God, with His joy, with His peace, with His kindness, with His gentleness. Not because I can give it to you, but will you seek the Lord for it? And will you not be discouraged when you begin to see what He's pushing out? Because it doesn't mean that you failed. You just have an awareness, because now you're not like the world who doesn't see. You're like the one who is filled, that can see the Spirit and say, I need more of that and less of this. This got to go. And that takes work. It takes work to remain full of the Holy Spirit. It takes effort. It takes work. It takes diligence. And it takes sacrifice to identify what I have filled myself with and to let it go as I get filled with what the Lord has for me. It takes work. But we have to realize it's work worth doing if it removes the things that don't bring me joy. If it removes the things that are standing between me and peace, and me in wholeness, me in gentleness and kindness. If it's the thing that's keeping me from being faithful in the areas where God's called me, it's a good thing and it's work worth doing. This morning, I offer you the opportunity to begin that work, because it's work worth doing and it's worth that's got to be done. Today you're full of something. What are you full of? And if it's something other than the Spirit of God and all that He would offer, are you willing this morning to displace
what you have for what the Lord can offer you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you today for this message, for the time we've gathered. I thank you, Lord, for what your Spirit gives us. I thank you for all that you've made available that we don't deserve, and I thank you that you pour it into us repeatedly, that you're with us forever, that you comfort us eternally, that you're with us in all places if we'll just let you be. Father, I pray that you would make us willing to make the sacrifice and do the work to be in your presence so that we can be filled with what you have for us. Lord, I pray this morning that your Spirit would work in the lives of those who you've gathered to hear this message, that you would begin investing in us and that we would begin receiving. And Father, I pray that you would encourage us, that we would not become discouraged when we become aware of what's inside of us that floats to the top, that we would just become more motivated, Father, to see it displaced so that we can become truly full to the point of overflow, the way your Son described it, with your joy, with those fruits of the Spirit that you desire for us to have. You're a good God. You're a gracious God. In the midst of good times and difficult times, we know that you're good, and you're filling us and with us always. Let us see that in a tangible way this morning. Let us leave here better prepared, not just to help others, Lord. We talk a lot about helping others. Let us leave here this morning more full of you than we have ever been. Let us leave here with more direction in where we should be going to satisfy what we lack than we have ever had. And let us remember those things. Whether the time be convenient or inconvenient, let us remember those things when we need them. We trust you to be gracious and honor your word and come through when those times are upon us. Thank you for bringing us together this morning. I pray that you'll keep us safe until the next time that you bring us together. We ask all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being with us this morning. Hope I'll get to see you again very soon.